me understand why they did this. You know, give me a psychological explanation.
No, there is no psychological explanation for creepy, disgusting. There's not, because bad is bad, and it's always going to be bad. And you know what? When you're a little kid, all you want, more than anything, is for them to love you. That's all you want. Because you want your mommy and your daddy to love you, and you want them to protect you, and you want them to keep you safe. And they're not doing it. And so you're doing everything you can to be perfect. And you know what? That's me. I was doing everything I could to be perfect. Because I had my magic thinking going on, thinking that if I just was perfect, that the hitting and the hurting and the torture and the trips to what my dad called the playroom, which was so far from it, would stop. And I know I'm talking to some survivors here, and I'm sorry. I'm sorry for your hurt. I'm so sorry for your hurt. Because you deserve to be loved and treasured and protected, and you weren't. Just like I did. Because none of us deserve to be harmed. And you know what? I didn't have any protective adults. None. But I did have a near-death experience when I was young, about 4. And I went to heaven and I saw Jesus and I sat on his lap and he told me that I had to go back, which was really sad. But he told me that someday I would get to go to heaven. And that was enough. And every night I prayed that children's prayer, "Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. And if I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take." And that was enough for me to pray that prayer every single night, praying that tonight would be the night I died. And then I woke up every morning so sad that I hadn't died. But I still got up, and I still faced each day. That's what you do when you're a child living in this world. So, it was on the job training, a lot of bars, a lot of truck stops. And you know, my dad was doing what many family businesses do. He was paying off his debt. I mean, parents do it for drug money. For my dad, he was doing it to pay off his bar tab. I mean, you know, we'd get in the truck and he'd go to the parking lot and then he'd send people out and I'd entertain them in the parking lot. It was disgusting. Sometimes he'd have special parties. And it was awful. And I began making my plans for my escape. I started saving money. In my child mind, I needed to have $800. And I knew that when I was 14, I could get a job. That, in my child mind, $800, and 14 years old, I could get a job, and it was going to be okay. Well, my mother committed suicide when I was 12. And you know, I do have to tell you that none of the women were any help. They all just treated me as, and I'll use the word, but I know it's a tacky word, but they all treated me as my father's whore. And that meant his stepwives, my stepmothers, I'm sorry, his second wives and his third wife. My grandmother, all of them, that was my purpose. It was my purpose. It was my purpose for my stepbrothers. It was my purpose. That was my job. My job was a usable resource. went to school, and I got good grades, and I never spoke to anybody about what was happening. And do you know why I never spoke to anybody? Because this is always a really big question that I know people have in their head. But they don't want to ask because they don't want to be guilty of victim blaming. And I know they don't want to ask because they don't want to go, why didn't you ever say anything to any of your teachers? And that's because nobody seemed as strong as the bad guy in my life. Because you know what another facet of my family's business was? Killing people. So when you've seen your father kill people, do you think you're going to tell somebody? Because not even the police seemed strong enough. I never entertained telling the police. I never even considered. I mean, why would I? Like, I could even think about it? That never entered my mind. I thought briefly in high school about perhaps telling an English teacher that I was a student, that I was a student aide for, but then rumors started around about him having an affair with one of the other high school girls. And I quickly just discarded that because I was like, well, I clearly can't trust him. No. And I wasn't going to drag anybody into that path of death. So when I became a teacher, one of the things I decided to do was I will be the strongest person my students know. I will make sure that they know while I can't get them out of their situation, I am strong enough to get them to the right person. And when I was a superintendent, I made sure those kids knew I was the strongest person in that community. And I broke up a sex trafficking ring, not once but twice in my small community. Yeah, small towns. Welcome to Americana. My son-in-law is a screenwriter. He said, I think that I could use your life as a superintendent to write a screenplay. But it would definitely have to be Showtime or HBO. It could not ever be on, you know, like regular TV. Because this is ridiculous. And I said, yeah, I know. It is ridiculous. But if it could be my life, you have to know it could be these other kids' lives. And sure enough, it was. And you know what? It took those children 4 years. Count them. 4 years of coming to my office, knowing me, loving me, and trusting me, telling me exactly what was happening, and me recording them and them knowing that I was recording them, me going to the state police with the recordings, and the state police still not being able to do diddly squat. 4 years before those children would say face to face to the state police what was happening. Then, death threats, stalking and harassment to me, before finally those people had their children removed from their home. 4 years of those children still living in hell. 4 years. By the way, I escaped when I was 17. I got a scholarship to go to college. I made sure that all of my scholarship applications were sent to general delivery in the town where I was going to school, not to the town where I lived, because the goal was I was being trained to be a hit person and a prostitute. That was my family training. So I graduated from high school and moved out on the day of high school graduation. I don't have time to tell you my story, but it's a very cool God-given beauty story. Several times I kept going back to visit my family because it's a hard thing to break. My last family rape was when I was 26, after I had already had two children, and it was at knife point by my stepbrother on the night of my father's funeral. By my stepbrother because he wanted to make sure I wasn't going to fail to help his mother do all the things she needed to process my father's will. It was the last time I had anything to do with my extended family. So I will skip over a lot of this because some of it overlaps with other with the general sessions. But it is the second fastest growing industry. Part of that is because it is, you can sell a drug once, but you can sell a person over and over again. That makes sense. Children are half of those who are trafficked. The average length of life once a child starts being trafficked is only 7 years. Now, death frequently is because of substance abuse at the hands of a perpetrator or suicide. There were some other children who were also trafficked at the same time I was trafficked. Another family, one of my father's best buds in his little group. And there were four children in that family. And one of the children survived to adulthood. And the youngest, and she went ahead and made it out into adulthood as far as I know, but the others all died, one from a drug overdose, and the other two moved on to become prostitutes and committed suicide. One became a male prostitute, one became a female prostitute. There were a lot of times when I had to put on sex shows with both the girl and with the guy. And it was particularly tough for the guy because he was a homosexual, but that didn't stop them from making, and the girl was a heterosexual, as was I, but that didn't stop them from making us put on shows. And I realized there's so many things about this conversation, there are so many things that just are creepy. I realize that. This is a tough topic. You have to understand, you have to do things. They make you do things, and you do them, because that's just what you do. The only line I could safely draw was, I refused to kill anyone. I didn't kill anyone. I was like, fine, you can kill me, no biggie. But everything else, I did. But I wouldn't kill anybody. And that was a big bone of contention. Numbers for males are very difficult to come by because males don't report well. In New York State, they have a study from 2015. 50% of those who responded to that study were male. So we know the numbers are high. For those who are forced into the sex trafficking or who end up in sex trafficking, we also know that transgender and LGBT are very high risk. Part of that is because their housing is so fragile. We also know it's because they are so disenfranchised and they lack support, and they are frequently removed from any sort of family support situation. We also know it's because they are very vulnerable to blackmail style situations. 90% of children who are sexually trafficked have been sexually assaulted by a family member and or from a family friend. And most of those children and teens who are sexually trafficked don't have a typical pimp like you see on TV. That's not the typical thing. It's usually an older friend that brings them into the business world. There's almost always some sort of gang involvement that this older friend is involved with. Frequently, there's some sort of desire to use the sex acts to pay off a debt, to cover up something, to protect family members from danger, or to protect them from some knowledge about something that's going on. Sometimes it's to get continued access to drugs. Sometimes it's to keep the continued love of this girlfriend or boyfriend. Sometimes pets can be threatened. It's not at all uncommon for this older high school boyfriend or girlfriend who smells great, dresses great, is just a real popular guy or gal, you know, to come, give you a ride home from middle school, take you over to their house instead, give you a drug-laced beverage that may or may not even be alcoholic, then film you while they rape you and or multiple other people rape you, and then use that blackmail evidence. I'm going to show your friends, I'm going to put it on social media, I'm going to everything, I'm going to show your parents, and that's how the nice middle-class kid gets tricked into sex trafficking. Well, that child goes home and is horrified, but then the older boyfriend-girlfriend, now if they've given you a drug that is addictive, then you're pretty hooked, you know, right then, you know, right, you've got to continue the business just to continue to get your high. So you're going to do it for that reason, but you're also now terrified that your family and your friends are going to find out. The last thing you want to know is that everybody at school is going to see it, you know, show up on somebody's website. The last thing you want is for your dad's job to find out that, you know, you know, let's say your dad has a security clearance of some sort, then you're totally trashed, you know. Oh my gosh, you know, and all of a sudden you just are totally, you know, and then they say, well, okay, so you just go to 10 parties and then I'll give you the video and all the copies. If you're in middle school, you're going to believe that. Absolutely you're going to believe that. Because you're in middle school. You believe it. Because of course you are. And then they give you this prepaid cell phone, and you have to show up down on the corner, and you have to sneak out of your room, and you go. And then as soon as you start to realize that you just can't maintain this lifestyle anymore, then and you start saying, I don't care, then they start threatening your younger sibling, well, that's fine, we'll just bring them in. We'll get them. Or your dog ends up poisoned and shows up on the front doorstep, and you know, that's how a kid gets brought in that isn't somebody. That's how the 70% happens. Yes, honey?
Are you using examples from experience, or these stories that...
These are kids that I have worked with. These are kids that I have worked with. And this is not from, this would not be my personal experience, but these are people that I have worked with. So, and yes, you want a coloring book?
Sure.
Okay. And if you want to trade, you can come up and trade. But there you go. But that's the middle class scenario. But you have to think about, logical thinking doesn't work when you're traumatized. You don't have the ability, you know, you don't have the ability for blood to get to your, to the front of your brain. I always call it, you know, the dinosaur brain, your reptilian brain. The blood only gets down here. It's dinosaur thinking. Fight and flight and freeze and fawn. You're right there in just those four responses when you're traumatized. I'm either, you know, if you're scary, do I just suck up to you? so that you don't hurt me anymore? Yeah, I'll suck up to you so you don't hurt me some more. I used to have a thing where I called it, let's make a deal. I'll trade you that bad sex act for one that I think is less bad. Can I do that? Can I play let's make a deal? Okay, let me play let's make a deal with you. Instead of that torture, can I trade you down for this one because I think that you like that one more? I would play that one with my dad all the time, which made me feel like I was the world's most manipulative person and that it was all my fault. Because hey, I was agreeing to it. Made me feel like I was at fault. It made me think I was a prostitute because I was agreeing. Yes, honey.
So I guess I kind of have two questions for
sure.
You, and you can just try to answer them the best you can. My first question is just like, how did you cope? Because even just sitting here listening to it, I can't imagine. Like, I'm speechless hearing about it. So I guess as a 14 or younger, or like all
yeah.
throughout your life, how would you emotionally handle that?
Okay, well, and that is a great question. One of the things I did, first off, I was really smart. I still am really smart. Okay, I should say that. My brain just went. All right, really smart is helpful. The early childhood factor of having had that near-death experience and always having the hope of heaven, major predictive factor. So I always had that connection with God and that belief that I was called to a higher purpose. Huge.
Mm-hmm.
That's huge for me. All right, so that's monster big. The other thing is, I know that I had a natural facility for dissociative, and I see your hand, so I'll get to you. So I know that I had a natural ability to be able to just dissociate when I needed to, so I always had the ability to go, okay, this one's gonna be bad, so I need to step out of the pain and be above it. And that's what I always thought of it as. And then, when I was about 10, okay, well, let me step back. When I was about 8, I went, I don't want to be these people. I know what, and I know exactly what situation it was. I ended up picking this monster fight with one of my stepmothers. And I pushed her buttons and ended up in like a girl fight, there is no other way to call it, a girl fight in the front yard with her in front of her parents' house where she was, we're basically having a girl fight where she's calling me my father's little whore and she's pulling my hair and slapping me. And I know I spurred it on. I pushed her to make it happen. And I realized, I don't want to be this person. I don't want to be this person who is in control enough of herself and the other person to make this happen. And I remember specifically thinking, I want to shut off all my emotions. I want to turn them all off. I will turn them all off. They will all go away. I will turn them all off, and then I will decide what emotions I can have. I will become a robot and I will decide what emotions are permissive and are good emotions. Only good emotions will be allowed. Now, I realize that sounds so contrived and calculating, but I just decided they would all go away, and they did. Then when I was 10, I went to the public library because I thought, you know, since I can go away and get above the pain, I would like to be able to do that better. So I think that's like hypnosis. And I went and checked out a whole bunch of books on self-hypnosis, and I studied hypnosis, and I learned how to dissociate more effectively. I called it hypnosis, but that's what it was. So let's hear it for being highly literate. And I'm also, because I wanted to fill myself with good characteristics,
I would sneak away on Sunday mornings, whenever we lived in a place where I could, I would sneak away and go to different churches, whatever churches I could get to, and I would just go sneak off on a Sunday morning. Generally I would hide out in a Catholic church because they never mess with unaccompanied children. You could go there and nobody bugged, if that makes sense. People just don't bug. They just always assume you're with somebody else. So, and you couldn't always count on that in another church. But that was nice, so they were always like a good safe haven. So I could always go hang out and hide. And I read the Bible a lot, because I was pretty sure I could figure it out. And so I did, because I just counted on my intellect to help me. So that's part of it. So I owe you a book, and then I'll get to you, but you have a question.
You don't owe me a book, I just want a card.
Okay.
I didn't it become just, you thought that was normal? I mean, and people don't understand that.
Absolutely.
But, I mean, because you knew no other thing.
Absolutely.
Yeah.
I did not know that people were not living like this
right.
until my senior year in high school, when I just happened to do a research paper on child abuse. And I was doing a research paper on child abuse, and I don't even know why I picked that topic. And even then, I didn't think about the sexual stuff as being odd. I just thought it was part of the creepy business. It was only the torture that I realized all of a sudden. I went, ain't nobody else has a playroom in the basement? And I went, I mean, because it had been really tough, like, doing school athletics and like hiding the scars and stuff. It had been really, and the bruises, it had been really difficult. I mean, you know, and coming up with excuses. And
which we're really good at, by the way.
Huh?
We're really good
absolutely.
At
absolutely. I mean, yeah, because I mean, I was always having a horse accident because I grew up on a ranch. I was always getting thrown from this horse. Oh, I had the world's stupidest horse. I was always getting thrown from a horse. Always getting thrown from a horse. Oh, I had broken ribs. Oh, I had, I mean, oh my gosh. You know, so many excuses. And I learned, the other thing is, I learned how my grandfather had a degree in microbiology, so I had read all of his college textbooks, plus we were on a ranch and we did all of our own veterinary work. Bovine antibiotics work really well on human beings, so I would just treat myself with bovine veterinary medicine. Let's hear it for can-do spirit. And, you know, it sounds so hideous when I say it lightly like that. And it's not. It is not light. But I really don't think I can do this presentation twice if I just bawl my way through the first 45 minutes with you. Does that make sense? Okay, so don't think for one second that it's a light story. And I don't think you do. I just don't want to just sit here and weep my way through the time. Okay, she had a question first, and then I'll get to you.
I just have a question. I've never heard of the idea of kind of the family business. The only kind of family business that I've ever heard of, like, being illegal is the mafia, but I think this is a different thing. So, I mean, I've heard of, like, parents and grandparents being abusive, but more in just kind of a single scenario situation. Could you explain more about that and how it is a family and how, why, like, how did he know all of these people for you to prostitute you to them?
You know, and that's one of the things that has always, okay, here's the thing, perverts, no perverts. It's like they have a secret club. And there was never, and this has always floored me, there was never a guy who came in and went, oh, yeah, with you, you're too young. Never once. Never one time. Never a lady who came in and said, oh honey, you're too young for me. Never one time. Never one time. Not once. Perverts must know how to speak to one another. I know when he had his little private parties, they were all of the same cloth. I know one guy was a regular that started with me when I was about, I don't know, probably about 12. And he kept up with me until about the time my period started, and then he quit. Because obviously I aged out of his type, you know? So it just, you know, I was not in his frame anymore, you know, and he was a regular, you know, we had regular date night, basically, and I really thought he was my boyfriend, and I was a little girl in love with him, you know, he brought me presents, and he was nice, and he didn't stink, and he was nice, he didn't hurt me, and, you know, so many of them were awful. And, you know, so there were others that were repeats that were just disgusting, you know, and they were people that my dad would hire as like day laborers on the ranch. And this, I was just a method of paying off the day laborer. Instead of paying them $50 for a day of labor, he would give them $25 and my services, you know, or he would just go to the bar and say, well, you know, pay for my tab and my daughter's out in the car. I guess, I don't know, because I wasn't in the bar, but I'm sure that that's how it goes. Truck stops are bad. I mean, truck stops are bad for prostitution anyway. Same thing. Once in a while, we'd go to hotels, but, you know, that was mostly just when I had to go with him for other things, but not very often. Most of the time, it would just be bar parking lots and truck stops, you know. I don't know. I wasn't there for the deal making. Sometimes he'd have parties where I think he would have people pay like a cover charge. And they would just pay a cover charge, and they'd get alcohol and services. No, that's okay.
And your mother, how did he meet your mother? How was your mother okay with this?
Well, they were both only children, and he was in college, he was a senior in college, and she was a senior in high school, and she divorced. Oh, I got a 5-minute warning. Okay, yeah. Well, so much for that, finishing this presentation. She divorced him when I was 6. And, but I would still have to go and spend summers with him. And she committed suicide when I was 12. He committed suicide when I was 26. Yeah.
I'm wondering, what has healing looked like been for you, and what's been the most helpful thing for you?
Okay, that's a great place to finish up with. That's fabulous. Probably one of the most healing components. Church family is huge, and being around normal people with normal loving relationships, that's been monster big. And the other thing has been my relationship with my husband, because we've been married for 37 and a half years. I got married when I was 19, he was 20. He asked me to marry him. We'd only dated about 3 months. He asked me to marry him, and I said, okay, I got a couple of things we have to talk about. I said, okay, you know I didn't have a very good growing up. And he said, yeah. And I said, well, I don't love you like I know a wife should love a husband. Because I know that I was infatuated with you when we first started dating. I said, but I know that I don't have the ability to love right now. That's just turned off. And he said, I'm not worried about that. And I said, okay. I said, I'm sure that I believe love is a choice. And I know God wants us to be married. He said, well, yeah, me too. Absolutely. Or we wouldn't be having this conversation. And I said, okay. And he said, I believe love is something that will grow. And I have enough love for both of us. And I'm not worried about it. And I said, okay, that's good. He said, okay, what's the other question? And I said, okay, well, when you are alone by yourself, do you ever get bored? And he said, bored? And I said, yeah, bored. And he said, no, I never get bored. And he said, why would that be your other question? And I said, well, here's the thing. If we're going to get married and I'm supposed to be the source of entertainment, I need to know that because I can't be a good dancing monkey girl for more than maybe 4.5-5 years. I need to know you can entertain yourself. And he said, yeah, you know, worries there. I can entertain myself just fine. He said, love, boredom, no issues. We've got it covered. And so we got married. And it has been absolutely fabulous and wonderful. And so it wasn't until after our son was born, about 3.5 years later, that I realized, okay, this is love. I have love now. I understand, and it was like then the venue was open and I could love my husband. And that was when emotions started coming back. And yes, there was a lot of counseling over the course of time, but also there's a lot of healing that comes from ministering to others, providing healing to other people. So, yes, ma'am.
One last question, sorry.
And then I'm done.
Yeah. How did you get rid of shame?
Okay, shame, am I totally done? Can I answer shame? Okay, the best way I have been able to get rid of shame is I personalize my experiences with the faith of someone I love. So I look at whatever my experience is that is coming to the forefront. Say it was like that 12-year-old part of me that was in love with the guy that I thought was my boyfriend. And I think about 12-year-old me and how I would dress so carefully for those dates with him and look forward to my dates with him. And then the horrible shame that would come up about how I was just a prostitute, just a horrible slutty slut of the world. And that horrible wave of shame that would come over me and how guilty I was. And then I would think of this most precious, beautiful 12-year-old girl I know named Abby and how there is no way Abby could ever voluntarily enter into a relationship with a 42-year-old man that her father was making her have sex with. There's no way Abby could do that. Because of course she would do that. And of course she would soak up any kindness because there'd been nothing. And if I couldn't blame Abby, I couldn't blame me. And so every time I would start to shame myself, I would go, you gonna shame Abby? You're going to look in those precious blue eyes while she's crying, telling you how awful she is? And you're going to tell her how awful she is back at her? And I go, no, I can't. And eventually my shame would lift. Because I realized I couldn't tell 8-year-old me that I should have chosen death instead of giving in. I couldn't tell 12-year-old me that I should have said no. There was no mile out that I could tell myself I should have said no to. None. So, thank you guys very much. If I owe you a prize, you can get a prize. There are business cards for